In 1966, England's football was at the top of the league and brought the World Cup back home. The undernourished figure of Twiggy was declared the face of the new generation. In Abervan, a coal mine collapse rained slurry and tragedy on a Welsh mining town, while across the ocean, America was raining bombs on Vietnam as President Nixon came to power. 1966 was also the year that Bill Hartnell grew tired of the TARDIS, and the first regeneration was activated, transforming from Doctor Who into Doctor Two, the cosmic hobo. Patrick Troughton became the Doctor for the Flower Generation.
The question I get asked a lot is, who's your favourite Doctor? And while dear old Patrick was still alive, I forbore to answer it because I knew he'd be embarrassed. But if I was in front of a firing squad, name your favourite Doctor, it would be dear old Pat.
When William Hartnell decided or was asked to leave the series, they were stuck with the problem, and they solved it with the idea that the Doctor, being an alien, could regenerate into another being, a way of prolonging his life. The research was on to find someone to take Hartnell's place. Very, very difficult job, because Hartnell had become so entrenched in the role.
Originally, the show wasn't supposed to last for more than, you know, a season or so. So when William Hartnell left, yeah, I mean, it was, you know, that was the most important casting decision they made.
Here was William Hartnell, who'd come along and been this very proverbial grandfather-type figure. Now, here was Patrick Troughton that came along and was more like your lovable uncle. You kind of felt more safe, I think, with Patrick Troughton's second Doctor Who.
Patrick Troughton was a good choice. He was quite a well-known television face and had been since the 50s. He was a very, very safe pair of hands, and very cleverly, either he or they decided to play him vastly different from Hartnell. He was much more flamboyant and much more sort of a storybook, Alice in Wonderland type character. And that change rejuvenated the show.
I mean, if it wasn't for Troughton, there wouldn't have been any more Doctor Who, because he was the first one who changed. So therefore he had to carry the series with lots of people going, "Well, who's this stranger?
Who are you and where do you come from?
Tell them, Doctor. Go on, tell them."
No.
For many people, Patrick Troughton had been sort of the Doctor that they had grown up with, and he was a wonderful actor, and he brought so much into the part, so much eccentricity and energy and charisma.
And he was just everything that you hoped somebody that you think is so wonderful when you see them on the screen is going to be.
So what's your theory?
He was charming and fun and helpful and friendly and generous as a performer.
I am impressed.
He was very much a character actor, and he approached the Second Doctor as a character and created this wonderful kind of elliptical, sly, hobo character, which was so different to what had gone before, and which the audience warmed to immediately.
Patrick Troughton, who was actually a very sort of quiet and shy man, created a character for the Doctor which wasn't like him at all. Of this sort of, he called it a cosmic hobo, this rather sort of scatterbrained, eccentric, mad professor character, you know, rather clownish. You know, he would, he didn't fight, for instance, you see. I mean, he'd always run away.
You will remain still.
Or, and we give him a burly sidekick like Jamie, the Scots lad, you see, who would do all the sort of physical stuff.
I'm afraid it's beyond my strength. Let me, Doctor.
I love the way he was always terrified. I think he's the only Doctor who was ever terrified of the monsters.
Oh! Ah! He's got my leg! Doctor, come on! It's no use!
But then he became brave and defeated them, and for a kid, I think that was really reassuring.
He must have stuck in my memory without me knowing, because when I saw The Omen, I went, "That's Doctor Who!" And all the way through the film, I was thinking, "What's Doctor Who doing in The Omen?"
gave it a lot of depth, and he's got a wonderful face, of course, that very lined face.
He had quite a sort of spooky face, not completely frightening, but not benign either.
And I always felt there was something rather sinister about him. I know he was a Time Lord, of course, and he got these great powers, but you've got the feeling now and then that you had to be step carefully around this man.
He could be so mercurial in his performance, and on one minute he's playing the clown, and the next minute he's actually quite manipulative.
He could suddenly turn quite nasty on you, although I know he was a goody at heart, but he was quite astringent.
I've heard this all before.
A lot of later actors who've played the Doctor have said that they've based their interpretation on him. So, I mean, he is a Doctor's Doctor, if you like.
Patrick Troughton was my inspiration, and I always thought of him as a comic Doctor, because he was the first one I saw and watched and became addicted to.
It was amazing to work with Patrick Troughton, because it was great fun for all four of us to work together. He was very giving as an actor.
Naturally. Don't expect any thanks.
Pat Troughton was mercurial, is the word that comes to mind, a sort of puckish figure.
We got on straight away. It was a pleasure working with him, as it was with all the other Doctors, but particularly Pat, and Pat was great fun to be with, great sense of humour, very impish, very, very good Doctor, I thought.
Yes, I know.
Patrick Troughton was my favourite, and he was also my favourite when we were working at conventions. I just thought he was adorable.
May I ask a question? Why did you submit yourself to freezing? You don't have to answer that if you don't want to.
It was brilliant that they chose somebody quite different to the first Doctor. And yeah, without Patrick Troughton, if he hadn't been as good a Doctor, the whole thing would have just collapsed.
Pat did the really difficult job. He did that first regeneration. And if he'd flunked it somehow, or not cut the mustard, there wouldn't have been a third. And logically, I wouldn't be sitting here talking about the wonderful world of Doctor Who.
I can't believe it. Big.
So for me, he's the governor.
The Tomb of the Cybermen is a fantastic story. It's possibly not the most well-made story, which is a bit of a shame. It's got a fantastic opening episode. Oh, there's some lovely stuff shot on film on location in this quarry. Beautiful, looks cinematic. And then, unfortunately, when it gets into the studio stuff, it all gets a little bit condensed. But behind all that is an absolutely knockout first-rate story with some very good actors and some marvellous set pieces.
It's almost like a mini Doctor Who horror story. A group of people confined in one space with almost like these big metal doors closed, with a menace from within, which they have to keep going to explore the tombs and refinding this menace time after time. It's a very exciting, it's very stark, it's a very horrific Doctor Who story. Another brilliant cast, Clive Merrison, Fraser Hines, the regulars, Deborah Watling, putting in very good performances. Yeah, a very good story.
There's a very, very touching sort of moment where the Doctor's new companion, Victoria, who's just lost her family and background and is travelling, this is her first adventure with him, and she asks him about his family, and that's the first time that had ever really happened in the series.
Are you happy with us, Victoria?
Yes, I am. At least, I would be if my father were here.
Yes, I know.
I wonder what he would have thought if he could see me now.
I think to a lot of people at the time, that moment encapsulated what was so good about Patrick Troughton's portrayal of the Doctor.
Yes, I know.
Well, the Tomb of the Cybermen always has a very special place in the hearts of Doctor Who fans, because for such a long time it was lost. It was always thought to be one of the greatest stories ever, but nobody had seen it. So then one day in 1992, it was rediscovered in Hong Kong, I think, and Rush released on video, and suddenly everybody could see this holy grail of Doctor Who. And it was just as good as we thought it was going to be. So this is, I think, probably one of the very, very best that Doctor Who's ever done.